With me here in the studio is the spokesperson for the opposition Syrian Negotiation Commission, Yahya Aridi. Joining us from Damascus is Ammar Waqqaf. He's the founder of the Middle East-focused think tank Gnosos. In Doha, we have Fadel, Abdul, Ghany, the founder of the Syrian Network for Human Rights. And in Moscow, the former Russian diplomat Viacheslav Matuzov. Gentlemen, all, thank you very much for joining us on the Newsmakers. Ammar, I'd like to start with you. Many people would say that the details in this list are an admission of guilt by Bashar al-Assad's regime. What do you say to that?
We're yet to understand what happened. These full lists, in a sense, can be positively looked at as a prelude to closing a hideous chapter in this very hideous war that we're having here in Syria. And in a sense, this could have, you know, hopefully a positive impact. People can settle their nerves, know that their loved ones have either deceased or not deceased, expect them to get out at some point, and so on and so forth. So in a sense, this could be, you know, a good step forward.
Yeah, but you know, that timeline that you're mentioning about closing a certain chapter, that's only part of the issue. And you say people will know if their loved ones are deceased or not deceased. That's the bottom line. But what about how they died, why they were detained in the first place? Surely it's not believable that the majority of these people died because of heart attacks. That surely can't be the case. And you well know, it's been well documented, what has happened to people in detention who have been held by Bashar al-Assad's forces. There are those details that are not here in this list. It's not complete.
Well, obviously we won't condone anything or any wrongdoing in a sense, but I think it's naive to assume that everybody that was taken in or taken by the security forces, arrested and so on and so forth, are peaceful demonstrators who want progress for their country. Some of them, actually a good number of them, are proved terrorists who have facilitated smuggling of guns, information for people to be killed and so on and so forth. They've committed crimes themselves. We're yet to understand whether those who were killed after some judicial process or express judicial process or whatever, or just died of malnutrition in a prison and so on and so forth. There is yet to be confirmation on that, and I think there is going to be a long process of that. But what we know for sure, that this is not, there is no government monopoly on these things. When Eastern Ghouta was liberated a few months back, the expectation was that 5,000 detainees would come out of that place who were detained by the rebels and so on and so forth, and only about 200 of them came out. Many parents broke down, and there was a huge issue at the time. Most of the detainees were either Syrian army operatives at the time when they were abducted or killed, or probably peaceful civilians who, for example, in Adra, the city, the labor city of Adra, women and children, some of whom we saw in cages paraded in Douma, for example. So there is a lot of mischief around that point. Now, what we meant by closing of a chapter is that once people understood that they're not going to see their loved ones anymore, they would be more ready, hopefully, to close a certain chapter and say, okay, let's engage in something else. If there is someone who I love who have deceased or is not going to show up anymore, then there are hundreds of thousands of others, and, you know, I'm ready to turn chapter. Hopefully that would be the case.
Okay. Yahya, your initial thoughts about this list, and we'll come on to the other chapter later.
Okay, well, 2 points drew my attention to what Ammar said in his intervention. One thing about Al-Ghouta, where they had 5,000 people and two of them showed up. And this should be addressed, really. The only description for those people in Ghouta were called terrorists. And what he is implying by what he's saying is that many of them died in jail. Then what applies to those people in Ghouta as terrorists then applies to the regime as a terrorist. Well, the other thing I want to talk about is that there are certain facts about taking people to jail by the Assad regime. One of the basic facts is that those people were taken as hostages. The impact of taking them into jail doesn't influence them personally, but it influences immediately their family, their loved ones, and the people who know them. If, for instance, the regime got 500,000 people, it means that the impact is on 5 million people of the 23 million people in Syria. So this trend by the Assad regime followed in taking people to jails for very simple reasons, in a peaceful way, for instance, saying no to the regime, or putting a like on a post, or being neutral, being not completely submissive to the regime, you are subject to be taken to jail, and you probably die. Another thing is that that drew attention in Ammar's statement is that the case of those people who were detained by the regime, and the fact that the regime is sending notification to their families that they died because of this or that, is that it was a case in doubt. Now it is a case in certainty that those people died under torture. And this is a real indictment, and we don't really know who gave this advice to the regime to expose this thing, and now they are thinking that they can remove this file. In reality, somebody who is leading the regime to The Hague when they expose these things and become in a case of certainty that those people died in jail under torture. And we have testimonies for that. We have data, we have notification, we have files documented, and the Caesar's photos are a very important example regarding this issue. 11,000 photos were shown to the American Congress that this is the case of Syrians in Assad's jails. This is a very important fact that need to be investigated, and this is the best way for taking those who tortured Syrian people to The Hague.
Okay, I want to pick up on three specific points you've mentioned, because so much of that is what we need to talk about. Okay, Fadel, let's start with you, because your Syrian Network for Human Rights says over the years of the war, more than 80,000 people have been disappeared. Yahya says when someone is disappeared and detained, it doesn't only affect that person, it affects the whole family. Nadim Houri, who writes for Human Rights Watch, mm-hmm. he says that a defector told him in 2014, this is the direct quote from the defector from the regime, detaining someone limits their ability to act, but disappearing them paralyzes the entire family. The family will divert all their energies to finding them. As a tool for control, it can hardly be beaten. Is it your opinion, Fadel, that the Syrian regime has deliberately been disappearing people?
Of course, this is the war of weapons used from the regime since the beginning, actually. So, tenth of Syrian citizens have been disappeared forcibly by the regime, actually. And those are not estimation. We have data, and we keep sending cases to the United Nations forcibly disappeared group. And they always correspond the regime. What's happened now? Now the regime is trying to reveal the fate of some cases. Now, approximately 600 cases have been revealed. Ammar said, okay, let's finalize this issue. But finalize it how? By this sadistic way, and to shock the family that we killed your lovers. We killed them because of torture, the majority of them. Some of them executed by the military court. But and without any independent investigation, we don't know what is the criteria for the regime to torture those Syrian citizens inside the center detention, or to sentence them by the military court. They don't have any types of rights by lawyer or by allow their family to know where, who's captured them, or who arrest them, or to visit them. They have been disappeared since more than 4 years, 6 years. And we have those individually. We have their Syrian cards, Syrian ID cards. We have the testimony from the families that where those have been arrested. So we have all the documents. By other hand, the regime now by announcing their fate, the regime actually accused himself. Why? Because the head of the regime, and Ammar knows that, and the Russian as well, declared several times that we don't have forcibly disappeared Syrians. We are not arresting people. So he denied those. Now, how is coming to know to reveal their fate if the regime not the one who actually arrest them?
Okay. You talk about potentially Russia knowing what was going on, but certainly one of the theories is, Viacheslav, is it not that Russia, Moscow, has put pressure on Bashar al-Assad to reveal these details now, and they're by no means complete. There are tens of thousands of other people. Amnesty International saying that 13,000 people have been executed who have been in detention. And in 2014, yep, 4 years ago, a defector came out with photographs. He had all the details of how people were treated in detention, where they were killed, how they were killed, where the bodies were placed. So why, 4 years later, is this news coming out? Is this Moscow's way of trying to move forward with the Syrian war?
Well, I think that we are now discussing the situation, how to exchange. Exchange by detainees, exchange by bodies of those who are their sacrifices is a struggle. 7 years it is war. And what is the task we should to look to today? If we choose the way to arrange, as I heard here, or investigation, make investigation, this is another one story. But if we arranging exchange of detainees or some other bodies of those who are felled in the battles, I think it is another story.
Yes.
I think that today we're discussing how to arrange peaceful. I don't believe that some international organizations like White Casks or are associated with them, humanitarian body, international bodies, are respond the demands, because Russia doesn't believe. And we do know exactly right now that White Casks were connected with terrorism.
Okay, that's a separate issue. Vyacheslav, that's a separate
false
issue.
False information for international bodies.
Okay, we're talking specifically about what's happened to people who have been detained by Bashar al-Assad's forces. Yahya, Vyacheslav says it's time to talk peace, that this is a way forward to reach a peaceful negotiation. You represent the opposition. Is it time to talk peace? Does this help?
Well, we appreciate this Russian position that they want to talk peace, because they have been since 2015 bombarding, killing people, etc., etc. I believe what is happening in Syria with regard to the release of these certificates that they died, the party that is behind this is Russia itself. Because Russia now believes that after the control of the geography, almost all the geography of Syria, now they are going to move into a political settlement. And one of the issues that was raised in UN Security Council resolutions, be they the Geneva Communique or Resolution 2254, is the issue of the prisoners or detainees or those in jails, in the Assad jails. It's not a matter of exchange. If the opposition has five people, the regime has 5,000. So this is the case. And we, as in the opposition, are against detaining the freedom of anybody. Now, Russia is moving into this direction because those files were brought up in Astana. And we discussed with Mr. Lavrentiev. We said the issue of the detainees, the prisoners, is a priority for Syrian people. And he promised at Astana 7 or 8 to go to Damascus and open this file with the Assad regime. And in the next round of Astana, he came back, and we knew what happened to him. Opening this file for the regime is deadly, period. Now, what is behind this pressure for opening this and settling this issue in their mind is the Russians. They are saying to them, well, the issue of the detainees is a very important one. Let's move it. Now the refugees also, we need to take care of it. Now the issues of the detainees, the prisoners, is a very crucial one. You are talking about 500,000 people and 55,000 pictures of those who were tortured in jails. 11,000 of them were shown in different places by Caesar.
Okay, let's put that question to Ammar. Okay, it's a very important question. Ammar, is Bashar al-Assad going to release the details of where these bodies are? Will the families get to see the bodies? Will there be a chance to perform post-mortems, autopsies on these bodies, which will show, presumably, you believe that they haven't been tortured, but will those post-mortems prove that? Will the families get the bodies?
Well, first of all, we're assuming that they died under torture. There isn't anything to say that...
That's the allegation from much of the world.
Whilst we know... Yes, exactly. That's the allegation, but it's yet to be proven. Let's not take that as a fact. Some of them might have died from all sorts of causes. Now, what the government plans to do, we don't know. We actually don't know. We're just here to monitor and try to explain what is happening. What their plan is, we don't know. Why they haven't made this move last year, for example, we don't know. Presumably, one might think is that they were thinking that at the time it might have led to more turmoil. Let's delay it a little bit, for example, to this year and so on and so forth, whilst the state is more stable and everybody is trying to buy in a more stable state. Now, there is this image that is distorting the whole there is this perception that is distorting the whole way we look at this. Take, for example, a state official whose task is to protect people. Would he be inclined or encouraged to take or arrest people and try to get word out of them, no matter how he does that, in order to prevent the next suicide bomb? We've seen, for example, in the past few years in the city of Homs, where suicide bombers targeted children and schools. Incident after incident, the people of Homs went to the streets and asked for the sacking of the governor. State officials have been throughout this whole episode, ugly episode, under tremendous pressure. They wanted to prevent suicide bombers from getting into civilian areas. Now, would they come and try to pluck out whatever information in order to protect these people? I'm sure they would. That's not condoning, though, that there was no apparently due judicial process where they were tried and whatever it is, even executed. We don't know. But this has been an ugly scene. Now, we need to look forward. And the way to look forward isn't only for people who had relatives or loved ones detained with the governments, but it's also the other side of the equation, which are people who had detains within the terrorist groups in, for example, Latakia, Damascus, Ghouta, and most recently, actually, in Suweida. People do care about these loved ones, and what they have been, I mean, I'll give you an example, personal example. I had a cousin who died in 2013 when his unit in Eastern Ghouta was overrun by, I think, Jaish al-Islam or whatever it was. Now, the Jaish al-Islam people kept ringing his parents using his mobile phone, telling them that your son is alive and we need this money and that money. They abused them, basically. They abused their emotions. There are all sorts of chapters, hideous chapters, associated with the detainees. It's not only the government.
Okay.
It's only part of it.
I understand.
The government is only part of it. So we need to look in a more holistic way.
Sure, absolutely. Okay, we're running out of time and you've been throwing it forward. I've been continuing to bring it back to the detainees and the updated registry of those who have died. So just in the last few minutes, Fadel, how do you see the future of Syria as far as Syrians themselves are concerned? Is it possible even when this eventually ends for such a divisive and brutal conflict to allow people who are on opposing sides to live in the same place? Or will those who eventually lose this battle have to leave Syria?
Of course, the Syrian society, which they make the uprising, will not accept that their lovers died because of torture or forcibly disappeared without any type of investigation. The accountability for those who committed the crime against humanity, tens of thousands of crime against humanity, the only way to move forward. We need the government and the regime to be to held accountable, actually. Otherwise, the Syria will be unstable for decades, actually, and the revenge will be the only way. It's unfair, actually, to compare the systematic tens of thousands of from crime against humanity from the regime himself by other like groups. If we compare the scale, the regime committed more than 85% from the regime and his allies, the Russian and the Iranian, 85 till 90% from the total crimes. So if there is no accountability, there will be no justice at all. The society will be unstable. So that, based on that, we believe that this regime will be unaccepted at all from the Syrian. And if the Russian care about the Syrian stability, they should bear in their mind to remove this regime, and of course the Iranian are engaged with the regime in those crimes.
Okay, we're just running out of time, Father. You mentioned Russia saying it should remove the regime. Viacheslav, that's never been anything that Moscow would accept. So what's the bottom line for Russia when it comes to resolving this conflict? Since your country entered the war in September 2015, Bashar al-Assad's forces have been regaining territory. When will you stop supporting the regime and allow the Syrians themselves to sort out a political solution?
I think that the Syrian government proved that stability and proved that it is governing all the Syrian territory, approximately. So now we are talking about exchange of those who felt in this struggle during 7 years. And future is only one, to forget about war, not to convert this discussion into the prolongation of war. It is discussion to how to end the war, but not how to arrange accusations, Hague Court, and many other. Is it necessary? It will be specialists who will investigate all cases. I cannot believe in many investigations because I do know that quite a lot of documents that were shown during 7 years of war were falsified. They were not true. There were means of war, but not means of peace.
Okay.
I think that now the question is how to achieve peace, how to help Syrian people, not only government.
Okay, listen, thank you. Yeah, I can give you 30 seconds, but no more. In terms of what Viacheslav says in negotiating the end of the war, where are we in 30 seconds?
For Russia, you cannot have a proverb in English that says you cannot have the pie and eat it. You can't keep the pie and eat it. They want to keep the regime. At the same time, they want just to settle all these things. It's like sewing a wound when it is still bleeding. This regime is the best prescription for the continuity of destruction, for detainees, for displacement of people, for the misery in Syria. They want to keep the regime and they want to rehabilitate it. At the same time, they want to close these files, which are unclosable, if I can say so. Now, as Vislav superficially believes that it's a matter of exchange of 5 people for 5,000 people, it's not that. We just sympathize with those people in the coast, in Tartus, in Latakia, in Sueda, like we sympathize with other people who have been being detained for 5 years or more now. It is a matter of opening this file under the pressure of Russia. Russia cannot do this way if they want Syria to come, Syrians to come back to life and to want Syria to start all over again. This is not the way to settle things.
Okay, and we have run out of time. I'm so sorry. Gentlemen, thank you very much indeed for joining us on the Newsmakers.